Psychotherapy and Healing. It is not possible to use the techniques and philosophies of the mechanistic paradigm to heal the effects and devastations of that paradigm. First of all, therapists must do the work in themselves that is necessary for them to move beyond the paradigm that has led to personal burnout, systematized codependent behaviors, and perpetuation of a system that keeps clients victims and also victimizes them. As therapists do their own process work, they may move to a paradigm in which healing, not just adjustment, is really possible. Psychotherapists cannot learn a new technique or method or philosophy. They must initiate their own recovery from the addictive process and make a paradigm shift themselves in order to be able to work in any creative, healing way with others. And that will probably not be psychotherapy as we know it. I truly believe that we are at a place in the history and development of the field of psychotherapy in which most of the people in the field can fully embrace the kind of shift in consciousness, belief, and functioning that will be necessary if any form of the helping professions is to survive. I've seen that as I put my sobriety first, there are more and more things I cannot do, such as interpretation, exercises, techniques, and control. Yet, my work life has become richer, easier, and much less stressful. The very approaches that were supposed to make my life easier actually made it more difficult. The following chart gives an interesting look at different healing traditions. I am convinced that the paradigm of the living process moves beyond all three. At present, I am working on a program for recovering psychotherapists. Due to space constraints, it will be presented in its entirety at a later date in another context. Suffice it to say that I do believe that psychotherapists can recover from their enmeshment in a paradigm that does not work for us, and as we do, our work will be completely different. Psychotherapy is harmful in that the science on which it is based sees people as objects, and those objects are only acted upon externally, denying the role of volition and self-action. This sets up a victim mentality, and victims never get better. They only get bitter. This belief system robs people of the possibility of taking ownership of their lives, and it prevents their full participation. Once we recognize victimization, we need to move on to what we need to do in ourselves to heal. We can never claim our own power as long as we are stuck in blaming others and seeing others as primarily acted upon. Psychotherapy, the way we have set it up, tends to perpetuate dependency and a victim status. As stated earlier, psychotherapy is also harmful in that it focuses upon understanding and figuring out. This sets up a system in which feelings and deep processes are avoided by trying to figure out and understand. However, psychotherapy is probably most harmful in that it provides a fix and keeps people away from their deep process work. It is analogous to giving a drug that suppresses the immune system. When the immune system is needed, it is not there. It is like taking an aspirin for pain only to discover that the pain was a warning to the body. When pain is suppressed, but the cause of the pain is ignored, the possibility for healing a potentially fatal disease is reduced. The aspirin helps with the symptomatic problem and gives a fix. It ultimately exacerbates the problem and prevents healing. In our codependency, we have settled for the fix and the need to be needed. And we have not moved to real healing because, in some deep way, that makes us less indispensable than we are as the fixer. What will the new paradigm look like in healing? I do not know. I have only gone far enough in this work to know that it will be totally different from what we learn in a mechanistic scientific paradigm. According to a recent Associated Press article entitled "Panic Disorder Often Misdiagnosed," for example, a panel of experts says those attacks of sudden, unexplained terrors that cause rapid heartbeat, churning stomach, flushing, and rapid breathing can be controlled if doctors and patients recognize the disorders. Emphasis mine. The experts further state that this is inappropriate fear and affects one in 75 Americans. People fear these attacks and feel they are having a heart attack, about to die, going crazy, or about to commit an uncontrollable act. End quote. A member of the panel, a New York psychologist, stated that panic attacks are often, quote, associated with stressful life events such as surgery, pregnancy, and even such things as high intake of caffeine, end quote. Of course, women are most affected by this disorder, and the onset is usually in the mid-teens or young adulthood. I found the next bits of information especially interesting in demonstrating how the addictive mechanistic paradigm functions. Drugs can hold the panic attacks in check for about half of all patients, though there is a danger the disorder will rebound powerfully if the drugs are stopped. More successful treatment has come from therapy, in which the patient is taught to confront and control unrealistic fears and panicky thoughts. Research is underway to determine the best combination of drugs and psychotherapy that can control the disorder. This is how a panic attack is viewed from a mechanistic scientific paradigm. First of all, the experts decide what the issue is, diagnose it, and prescribe from their paradigm. The experts also decide the feelings are inappropriate, even though they are linked to life experiences. This is a good example of what I have called the disrespect, violence, and arrogance of that paradigm. In a living process paradigm, the assumption is that feelings are valid and are not present without a reason. If the feelings are more intense than those one would expect from the current situation, that is often the clue that a deep process is coming up, one that probably has little or nothing to do with the present door. What would happen if the public understood this about their internal healing process and viewed attacks like these as an opportunity for healing? Also, there was a mention that these attacks could be related to a high intake of caffeine, a drug, but no indication of whether the investigators really asked about the relationship of these attacks to addiction or growing up in addictive families. My guess would be that they would find a high correlation with both. Early in the article, they mentioned that because the syndrome had not been adequately diagnosed, doctors tended to treat the symptoms and not the cause. Then they suggest the same thing, a very simplistic, mechanistic cause and effect approach to the symptoms of drugs and a therapy modality based on the illusion of control. Viewed from a living process paradigm, the attack is a symbol, a door that is probably ushering in some old issues that are ready to heal. The person needs support to stay with the feelings and see what comes up. The fact that they state that drugs are helpful for some, but when the drugs are stopped, the attacks come back with more force, clearly supports what I have said about our deep processes. If we miss them the first time around, they will recycle, and each time they come up, it will be with more force. Then the therapy suggested is clearly one based upon the illusion of control, and one that asks people to judge their feelings negatively and try to control them. The entire focus is on controlling the disorder, which probably means that the issue the attack is raising will erupt in some other form. How different it is if we respect these feelings, let the deep process run its course, and in learning to trust our deep process, learn to trust and heal ourselves. I have been actively involved in evolving a new paradigm for emotional, psychological, and spiritual healing for almost 30 years. And only now am I realizing the true meaning of a paradigm shift. The civil rights movement and the women's movement let me know different systems, and still both are enmeshed in the old mechanistic science. I did, however, learn that I cannot understand everyone with my mind, and, most important, I cannot interpret them from a system that does not understand them. I have also seen the importance of grassroots and self-defined groups of codependents and addicts. To heal, groups need to get away from being under the definition or control of the professionals. My observation is that recovery groups that are a major impetus for paradigm shifts have come from the Midwest, not from the East or the West Coasts, which are usually the centers for idea generation in the United States. Centers for the generation of ideas tend to be more embedded in the modernistic scientific paradigm than grassroots places. This may be too simplistic, and I think there is some value to looking at regionalism and the U.S. culture. We need to start listening to those who are participating in life and not so much to those who are thinking about it. This may well mean listening to the people of the planet who have been disenfranchised by the mechanistic scientific worldview. All of this work is, indeed, a process. In doing it, I have had to be willing always to be ready to let go of what was true for me yesterday or 10 minutes ago. When I live in process, I learn to trust that the process will take me where I need to go. This paradigm does indeed require a life of faith. The new paradigm is one that comes out of being more fully human than we have ever before realized, and recognizing and being fully in our bodies while being a part of and participating in all creation. It is a participatory system that requires full participation. In that participation, we have information and experience available to us about all of creation. In living in process, we are part of a universe that is a hologram, and the holo movement is our reality. In the living process system, at some level, nothing is ultimately bad or good. It just is. And our issue is to learn from the experience and integrate it into our being and within the cosmos, which results in an evolving process of all creation. We cannot live our process without a concern for and participation in ecology and the environment. We are the environment, and what we do with our internal and external environment affects all of the creation. The new paradigm recognizes and supports spirituality as a given. There will need to be a shift of consciousness from our human-centered perception of the world. This, in turn, will change our religions and our consciousness. Reconciliation with all creation will become possible. Finally, psychotherapy as we know it will no longer exist. The kind of healing that deep process work reaches is not amenable to modern psychological techniques and understanding. Whatever replaces psychotherapy will have to be integrated into the complete life of the individual, the planet, and the cosmos. It cannot be isolated from life and will probably be communal in form. Deep process work will be only a small part of living the paradigm. The simple skills of noticing and naming will take on new meaning, as these will be very important skills in living a new paradigm. People have often said to me that it is not surprising that living in process and deep process work was developed by a woman, because it is time for the feminine principle to reemerge. I do not fully agree with this. I have noticed that deep process work is like the birth process, but men can do it as well as women. Perhaps it is easier for a woman to notice these things. However, I do think that dividing the world up into a masculine-feminine dualism is part of the problem. Strength is not masculine, and softness is not feminine. Many Native men are attuned to the process, often more so than Western women. If we are really talking about a hala movement here, we all participate in the all. What we have called masculine and feminine are just labels for processes that exist. We all have access to all processes at some level beyond our understanding, choosing what we need, learning what we must learn to participate in the ongoing creation of the universe.